Until you turn the microphone on and without telling anybody.
It's 7 o'clock and I want to rock.
You know what? That's how you're rolling now?
No,
bitch.
Not really. I thought
yeah.
you were.
Yeah.
No, I said, here we go.
No, you did not. You did not!
I said, here we go.
I was singing.
You were singing. I wonder if they heard you. We can listen.
I was singing.
We can listen later.
Oh, no.
Oh no.
The plant opens, then the plant dies or the flower dies?
Is it like
opens,
our...
then dies overnight. The flower must.
What kind of, what is that? What?
It's a night blooming cereus, C-E-R-E-U-S. I don't know, I have to look it up.
Okay.
Opens
a night blooming cereus.
I'm gonna look it up.
I like
let me
that.
Write that down.
I like those. They're beautiful.
I love plants.
Yeah.
As you know.
Yeah, I know. I know. So, let's see. Here we are. Throwback Thursday. So, I'm thrown back to the early days of the show. This is, in May. Most of these stories were originally told. You can check your synapse function during the telling of any of these stories.
Oh, Tim said great harmonies in that song, by the way.
Yeah, well, thanks. That was that would talk about throwing back. I discovered that in my archive the other day. That's I forget where we were. We were playing in DC in 1987. It could have been the Black Cat. I don't even remember. We played some crazy places that year. And yeah, that was 87. That was Rat Race and Johnny. That was where it
yeah.
started.
Dave was singing like a bitch too.
Yeah. No, he let me tell you what, I listened
top
to the
of
whole
his
thing.
Game there.
He was, yeah, absolutely.
Great voice.
Mm-hmm. And we sang good together too. I mean, we pitched well together. So, you know, because that's usually me singing. If there's only two parts, it's me singing the second part.
Look,
but on
yeah,
that,
we're almost like brothers.
On that, yeah, well,
yeah. You kind of yeah. had that genetic thing going
yeah,
on.
Yeah, we kind of did. Well, listen, I took my cues from him. I mean, he was the.
Okay, now you know we don't do gloom, but Mark Visconti wrote, "Unfortunately, he can't say Happy Thursday because whenever he comes in, he says Happy Wednesday, Happy mm-hmm. Thursday. He says he can't say Happy Thursday today. Not a happy day for me and my family, but thank you for your condolences, Steve."
Well, we certainly understand, Mark, and but what you wrote was absolutely appropriate and 100% right on. And, you know, listen, strength and healing, which, you know, you'll need. And
we are sorry for the loss.
Yeah, we are certainly sorry for the loss. I mean, yeah. That one, that hurts. And yeah. It sounds like you had a great relationship. So that, my friend, is probably the biggest gift you could ever get in that situation, is to be able to talk that way about your dad mm-hmm. or your mom or, you know.
Yeah.
So that's you're very
blessed.
I know it's a sad day, but you're a very lucky guy, and you should always remember that. So, we have some sound effect or something that make me feel better.
Oh,
now?
I gotta get my button.
Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, well, how come we missed this for Pat Romano?
Happy birthday!
Oh, I don't know. I'm not familiar with that button.
Wow.
I'm not.
Why? Because it says happy birthday on it?
Well, it's on the other page.
Right, I know it's on the other page.
That's why.
So, story time. Okay, going back to, did I say May, March, May? May.
I don't know what you said.
May, because I remember May the 4th be with you.
Oh.
Yes, May. So this is, it's, I'm sure you've heard me tell it before, but it's funny. And always to go back and listen to me tell it back, you know, back in the day. when it was still fresh. It's not that it was all that fresh, but it was fresher than it is now. So this is just a little fun, a little eccentric genius fun. This is, you'll see. It's a story about Alan Today and Rat Race Choir and a club called Speaks, and you know the rest. Okay, this one, I'm going to file this one under Do You Remember? Friend called me after a show, a couple days ago maybe, and said, do you remember the time that you guys blew out the power at Speaks? I said, yeah, as a matter of fact, I do. Tea break. And he said, well, did I ever tell you that I was in the area, working in the area that day when the crew was loading in? And I said, no. You never did. And he said, well, I was in the area and it was about 4 o'clock and I knew those guys were going to be loading in. He said, and so I drove over there. Speaks. The biggest. He said, and Alan had something that he called a distribution box. And I said, yeah, I know what that is. And what it was, I mean, you know, back in the day, we had the house in the Hamptons, and Alan had his workshop in the basement, and he used to build all these amazing cabinets and stuff for us to use, live. He built PA cabinets, and he also built the first real quadraphonic unit that bands ever used in a club or anywhere. I don't think anybody was using quad before Alan built that system. But what he realized was that because of all the extra power that he was drawing using this quad system, he needed more power than he could get out of one or even two circuit breakers. So my friend tells me that he goes, and then, you got to realize, like, the crew would show up hours before we did. And they'd, back the truck up, they'd bring in the stage gear, they'd bring in the production, sound and lights, and they'd set it all up and do whatever they did, and they'd ring it out, and Alan would do his thing, and so on and so forth. So on this particular day, my friend drives over to Speaks to watch them set up or see what's going on, and he sees Alan with what looks like a casket. It was really that power distribution box. And he comes out of the back of the truck with a pair of jumper cables. And John said he clamped two of the jumper cables into the box, which was outside the dressing room door, outside of the club. And he took the other end and jacked straight into the mains before it ever got to their fuses or meter boxes. He was drawing direct power right from the pole. Well, we didn't know this. I didn't know this. Maybe somebody did, but I didn't know it. And he pulled down so much power that night at Speaks, and I think it was a Wednesday night, packed house, 2,000 people, a line out the door, one of those, and boom! Not only did we take out the power in Speaks, but we blew the main transformer that took out the power for 1,800 other homes or businesses or whatever. And it took 2 hours before they could get the lights back on. And I don't remember, what other mayhem ensued. I'm sure I took advantage of the darkness for some nefarious crap. I don't think we left. I think we waited till the power came back on and we played. Because, back in those days you could play pretty late. So, yeah, that was... And then when he said that to me, I'm thinking to myself, wow, I do remember that. And Alan was... first of all, Alan was a genius. He really was just incredibly talented. And when I told the story about Warner Brothers the other night, I neglected to say that we were there for 2.5 days without anybody knowing it, and we finally got popped by a security guard. And of course, Alan lost a beautiful job as an engineer of Warner Brothers, sacrificed it for the greater good of the band. And hats off to Alan. He's I hope he's doing well. I haven't connected with him in a while. There he is. There he is. Styling. He was absolutely the fifth member of our band. He was as important to our sound as anybody on the stage. And there you go. And I see, I think I see a picture coming up that's going to lead me into my next piece. But actually, maybe what I'll do, because I have a lot of different things and I have a ton of stuff to play for you.
Hey, you don't know what you're doing, buddy. Get a job.
What? Yeah, I liked that story.
It was a good story.
Now, Tim says, ooh, I hope you were busted.
Nope. No.
Why do you hope that?
Yeah, why would you hope that? That we were busted for knocking out 1,800 homes or whatever it was? I didn't find that part out until recently. I remember the night that we blew the power out.
And it was not your doing.
No, I didn't do it. But, you know, Alan was, he was on the ragged edge, man. I mean, you know, he was pushing technology. We all were, but, I mean, Alan was like, you know, in the sound world, he was just, he was amazing. I mean, we did so much damage to so much equipment. He had deals going where he would get our Gauss speakers or from the RPA reconed, because we, and then I forget, there was once an argument about whether or not we could put grill, you know, screens over the speakers in the PA, because we didn't want anybody to poke the speakers. You could, and Alan said, oh, that'll change the sound. So, but hey, listen, you know what, if you can hear it, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so let's see.
Okay.
So yeah, I found some cool stuff for you. And it's fun. It's fun for me to go back and remember, you know, I mean, these are the earliest days of us, and not that we're, you know, on network TV now, but certainly the production value has risen a bit. You know, now we're out here in space. Well, we've been in space. We really have for most of time. So yeah, there you go.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Oh, well, tomorrow, yeah, we have, I'm hoping that somebody special comes in tomorrow, because it will just be a riot if they do. Everybody else that comes in, all our regulars, Mousy, Booker, Joe, I owe Joe Castaldi a good pasture. I'm going to try and figure that out. And Tom Heinisch. By the way, Tom, if you're watching, we took the gig at the Suffolk Theater. So,
yeah.
And did I, have I said that too much? No.
Well, yeah, I think you told everybody that the Vernon Kelton Band, the yeah. Roy Orbison Experience, is playing at the Suffolk Theater on August 6th.
You know, when we first started the show, and I realized, because you know, I haven't done clubs per se in a long, long time, and when I realized how popular tribute bands were, it gave me a whole new respect for the genre, realizing that these are people that are carrying on the torch for, you know, or you won't hear that music again. And so all the success of all the bands that I've had on, is it Kashmir and Double Vision and Tony, who does the Paul McCartney thing.
Right.
It's just, I mean, everybody's really bringing their A game.
Hugo and Lance and Journey. Hugo,
right, man. So it inspired me to get on board.
And we even had a Bon Jovi one.
Yeah. Oh, we've had a lot mm-hmm. of them. I mean, and it's great that they do it, because it's a whole different thing. It's just.
Oh, wait, now Tim is clarifying something.
Yes.
He had said, ooh, I hope you were busted. Then he came back and said, we're not. No, yes, we're not. And then he says,
we're not.
Miss Key, not busted. I mean, I want no busting. And Sue says, see, if you just looked before you click send, check your words.
It's an interesting
and
concept.
Tim says he
first
gets
of all,
too excited.
Tim, let me give you a hint. And I promise you, if you do this, I won't think it's screaming. Put the caps lock on.
What?
Well, because it's bigger.
Oh, I hope you were busted.
No. No, so he can see it.
It, but then we'll think he's
or put
screaming
your glasses
it.
On. Or your contact.
Like Sue said, read it before you hit send.
Read it before you hit send.
That happened to Steve with a neighbor of ours.
Oh, shit.
He told the phone what to say.
Told the phone
the
what
shirts,
to say.
And he said, any money where... our neighbor said, I'm too fat for those shirts. And Steve said, no, Eddie Money wears them. And he meant to say... And you're fitter than him. But the phone said, and you're fatter than him. And Steve hit send thinking it said fitter. And he wrote back and said, well, I know I'm fatter than him. And it was like, oh, my God.
Yeah, so blame it on the spell check.
Well, it was. Ever since then, you've really tried to
it was. Yeah, I read things
it.
Now. And so, but that's why, you know, a lot of times you see caps. But that's okay. All right, so a short gratuitous break. Here you go.
Okay.
Let's see what this one is. Ooh. Just a quick reminder that,
that's
you know,
right. And we are having a summer sale.
Having a sale, so you know. So let's see. Where do we go next?
I think we go to the next one.
Why no? But what is that?
Shopping with Johnny.
Oh, man, this is a weird one. And this goes, you'll remember. I wish I had a, you know what? I'm going to try and find a picture of this friggin' shirt. Hang on a second.
What shirt?
The striped shirt. I'll find it.
Yeah, all you gotta do, he wore it at Ichiku Park.
Oh, okay. Alright, that's close enough. Images.
Meanwhile, I'm gonna look up that night blooming
where is that?
I have.
How come I don't see it?
We have something called night blooming jasmine, but it blooms during the day. Ooh,
confused.
That's real pretty, Sue.
Confused, are ya? Of course, I mean, I see every picture
the
in the world except for the one I'm looking for.
Flowers last less than a day. We have, you know, corn plants that you have in the house? We had them in the house and we decided to plant them outside and they get the sweetest smelling flowers twice a year. It smells like better than jasmine or gardenia.
Is that it? Is this it, Law?
What?
Oh, that's the. That's us. Well, I guess I could. No.
Oh, no. Did he wear it? No, he wore it at Woodstock. I'm sorry.
Woodstock?
Yeah.
No. Yes?
Yes.
No. Woodstock. This is Woodstock. He's wearing a black shirt. I'm sorry, guys. I'm trying to find this picture of this stupid freaking shirt.
And he wore it all the freaking time. It's not
it
a stupid shirt. It's
no,
a very
it's not,
cool
yeah,
shirt.
It's a great
and
shirt.
You
and
picked it out.
And it's very important to the story. I did pick it out, but I, you know, I'll tell that in there. Is that it? Yes! Ha! It's a terrible picture, but you'll get the idea. And, of course, you click on it, and that's not the picture. All right. Well, you know what? That's showbiz, kids. Oh, there it is. Here it is. Here it is. Here it is. Here it is.
Wait. Roger Chaffee said, will Steve and Laurie make the trip to New York for the Suffolk gig? Who's playing? What are you talking about?
Us. Where we go to see Vernon Kelton.
Oh, no. We live in Florida.
Yeah, we live in Florida. Okay, so anyway, here, let me... Oh, wait. Will it play this? I'll probably get busted for it. Oh, okay. Here we go. This is the shirt. If I turn the... Nope, wrong. How about...
Yeah.
it's all different colors, that shirt. See it? Stripes. I don't know why it stopped. Is that why? I don't know. I'm probably getting busted by the sound police or some shit. But
nah.
But there you go. That's, I don't know why it's not playing anymore. Play, John, play. Anyway, that's the shirt that is at the center of this story. See if I can show it to you better than that. Nah, not great. Roger, help me out here, you singer. Oh well. Okay, so you got it. You'll get it. You get it, right? It's a multi-colored, like black and color and black and color and black and color, all across the shirt. Coolest shirt ever. Here comes the story. Because shopping with John, I remember the first time this particular story happened in 97 or 98. But my original shopping experience with John, the very first shopping experience, was Coat Day in Washington, D.C.
Right.
Actually, the day after that gig that I just played for you.
Wow. How weird is that?
Right. We were looking for eggs. That was a Saturday night.
Oh,
and you,
right.
Me, and John walking through D.C.
He wanted eggs.
He wanted eggs. That's all he... And
it was
what?
Like 2 in the afternoon, and nobody
was
serving
lunch. Eggs. And Snooty wearing
no
like
eggs.
Some... We're in some hotel that's
we were
like
in Georgetown.
Good for everybody.
We were in Georgetown.
Oh, well, okay.
Yeah. So. And then we found like an old
and
diner.
We found an old greasy spoon
with homeless people in it.
Homeless people.
And John said, we'll eat here. They have eggs.
Yeah, he said, go in there and see if they have eggs.
We did.
I want eggs. So I go in and I said, you know, are you making eggs? Yeah, we making eggs.
Yep. So we did, and we
so
had
we
fun
in there.
So we went
in there,
and
John is dressed in, you know...
Like John.
We had Coat Day before that, didn't we?
I think so.
So now we're wearing these ridiculous coats with collars and fur and just...
We don't do that anymore. No.
But we were, and we look like, I don't know what, in this greasy spoon. And there's homeless people in there, and...
We were just sitting at the counter.
Yeah, we're just sitting, the three of us at the counter. I mean, this is like, you know, where was a cell phone when you needed one?
We didn't have a cell phone.
And some guy comes up to John and says, I got to eat filet mignon because I ain't got no teeth.
And he showed us
no teeth. That's why he had to eat filet mignon. And John was like, oh, okay. and where are you from?
Yeah, I said that. I said, where are you from?
She starts interviewing the
And then I said,
guy.
He's from London, England. And John looks at me like, what are you doing?
like he's going to head over there and meet you at your house, right? Oh, shit. All right, so here you go. Shopping with John. And let me tell you what. Whether it's shopping at Tesco, which is owned, that's grocery shopping.
Yeah.
He needs two baskets and there's still stuff falling out.
And let me tell you, in England... They like their candies and their cakes. There's not one aisle. There's like
three.
Four,
there's
three
candy aisles and three ice cream aisles.
With one thing looking better than the next.
I mean, you might as well just walk down the aisle like this and not, which.
That's all we wanted to eat when we were there. And it's so good. Their chocolate is a lot better than ours.
Yeah, it's, you know.
Yeah.
So, on that happy note, shopping with John.
Yeah.
Thursday. And it is Thursday. So yeah, I've got some cool stuff planned for you. I rooked you guys out of the Mont Blanc story yesterday, which I'm going to start with today. This is a funny story. It says a lot about who John Entwistle is. Not was, I don't like was. No, it does. It speaks to his character, this particular story. It's funny. I mean, he's a humorous guy who takes Christmas very seriously. Shops year-round for Christmas. Oh, no, that's his excuse. But I, you know, told you yesterday, stayed up all night watching the Home Shopping Network. And trucks would come every day, dropping off sheets and teapots and God knows what other stuff. Loved to shop, Johnny. Loved to shop. And we did... We did quite a few shopping sessions together.
I'll tell you one interesting story about that shirt, his favorite shirt that you see with the multicolored stripes. He wore it at Woodstock. He wore it with the Who. It was absolutely his favorite shirt. I'll tell you the story of that shirt. We were playing Atlantic City. And I'm trying to remember the name of the place. Might have been Caesar's. It doesn't really matter. Somebody will tell me. And by the way, you fact checkers out there, I don't give a crap. If I get a fact wrong, this is not about history. I mean, it is. But we're not writing this down. This is supposed to be fun. So if I screw something up, don't take me to task. If it was 1987 instead of 1988, or if she was tall and not short, or if there was more than I thought, you know, just give me a break. Now, so let's get back to Atlantic City. We're playing in Atlantic City, and it was so crowded that we had to be taken to the stage in an ambulance, which was like, okay. Usually we get taken away from the stage in an ambulance. No, not really true. Okay, so he says to me the night, we pull into Atlantic City the night before, and we hit the sack, you know, because we had the show the next day, and he said, you want to do some shopping in the morning? I said, I'd love to do some shopping in the morning. Let's go to, I forget what it was, Davidoff or some one of those Atlantic City shops with the amazing clothes in it. So, of course, I get there first. And I'm shopping around the store, and I've got shirts, and I've got shoes. And all of a sudden, I see those multicolored striped shirts. And I said, wow, those are cool. There was two of them, two. And I went and I picked them both off the rack, and I said, these are mine. So now I've got this way overpriced pair of black suede shoes and these two shirts. Oh, I had another shirt, and I had another silk shirt with a nice box pattern on it. So Johnny comes walking in, and he sees the shirts. And he goes, oh, I got any more of those? I said, nah, last two, man. He said, really? Snatches them out of my hand. Looks at the collar and says, these are large, too small for you, and takes them and walks away. Now, I'll tell you something that you might not know about those shirts. He was cremated in one of them. That's how much he liked those shirts. So I'm glad I gave it up. Plus, large, not me. But that was John. But that's not my Mont Blanc story. So let me set this one up for you. You know what a shoppery is, right? I mean, I told you what a shoppery is. And I told you about how much he loves Christmas. And you can see the Mont Blanc pen. And I actually have mine around here somewhere. I gotta find where I put it. Certainly didn't use it for making notes. Ah, there it is. This is it. This is mine. And like I said yesterday, the little mountain, Mont Blanc, white mountain, and you get the little white mountain on the top. And there's the maroon one. Oh, God, this is such a great story. Okay, so let's see. All right, I'm just going to jump right into the Mont Blanc. Because you start talking about John and shopping, and you could go anywhere. I mean, it could take you anywhere. It could take you to Shepler's, where he buys 200 Western shirts and doesn't even check the size. Another story. But we're not going there. We're not going to the truck stop for farm animals, plastic farm animals. We're not going for the old people fishing glasses. Today we're going for the Mont Blanc. Going for the Mont Blanc. Okay. So, I don't even remember what tour it was. And by the way, you're going to want to stick around because I'm telling a story that I don't often tell because it's hard for me to tell. And just thinking about it makes me choke a little bit. But this is a classic Entwistle. Luongo story, and I'll tell that next. Got pictures, the whole nine yards. And I've got a Corwood story to tell. That's the one for you, Les. So stick with me today, guys. It's going to go a little up and down, a little sideways. It's Thursday. All right. So there's the duty-free shop.
Do you think I should put something that says previously recorded?
There's the Mont Blanc pen. Now, John if he saw something he liked, he bought it in every color. You've seen those leather jackets from North Beach Leather. He had the silver one, and the bronze one, and the gold one, and the black one, and the zebra striped one, which he wore a lot, and the five shades of blue, and so on and so forth. He loved to shop. And most of the times, when he did shop, people gave him discounts. I mean, you know, why not? They want to be in Johnny's good graces. Oh, there it is. See? And that's a picture from the Mont Blanc website. How cool is this? Bringing you the truth, whether you like it or not. Okay. So, I drop him off at Kennedy. He's going to go home. Christmas is coming. He's got to get home. I think I forget when we ended the tour. I don't even remember what year this happened, but this is a funny story, so I'll get on with it. So, he always liked to, you know, buy out the duty-free. He'd buy Remy, and he'd buy cartons and cartons of Winston 100 cigarettes, and just all the things that he loved that, you know, he could get in one place. And I mean, it was like a rodeo when he got on the plane. Actually, they have it waiting for you when you get off the plane. But on the plane, you can buy things too. Not duty-free, but you can buy things too on the plane. And the things on the plane are very expensive. I bought my wife a cross with some stones in it, and every time she wears it, I kind of shake a little bit. But you know what it is. But it's great for the duty-free is great for, fragrances, Hermes, that kind of stuff, you know, high-end stuff. But like I said, on the plane, no. They're figuring you were hanging out in the VIP lounge, you got a little drunk, now they're going to sell you some stuff on the plane. Okay. So, John gets home, I give him a day to relax. He actually calls me the following day after he gets home. I said, so, what'd you get? I got some Rebbe, I got Lisa some Hermes 24 Faubourg, and I got some, there's a certain kind of truffles that he likes, and, you know, chocolate truffles, and so on. So I said, really? And he said, yeah, I bought some pens. You what, man? I bought some pens. Where'd you buy those? I bought them on the plane. Pens? Like more than one pen? How many pens? 10. 10? Yeah. What kind of pens? Mont Blanc. Okay, I said, you know, they probably almost double the price on those. I mean, the cheapest Mont Blanc pen is $100. The one that's up there, now that's a fountain pen. But they're really, really expensive pens. Why? I guess, you know, it's... Why is anything expensive? Because if that's what you want, you pay for it. Okay, so anyway, buys 10 Mont Blanc pens. And I said, let me see, you know, tell me what they are. And he said, well, I got a white one, I got a yellow one, I got a marbled one. And he's giving me all the colors, and I'm writing down all the colors because I want to remember what he got in case I'm going to get him a Mont Blanc pen. I want to get him one that color he didn't have. So, I said, well, why'd you spend all that money on those pens? Now, when I tell the Corwood story, you'll see a lot of pictures in the kitchen, and that's where everybody hung out. And John used to sit there, quiet as a mouse, television blaring it on 100, doing crossword puzzles. He loved to do crossword puzzles, and he did them with a pen. Didn't do them with a pencil, did them with a pen. Proper crossword puzzle doer. And I said, well, why'd you buy all those pens? He said, because I'm getting sick of people stealing my pens. I got to look all over the place for Mont Blanc pen, for my pens to do my crossword puzzle. And there's never a pen around. I said, okay, so let me get this straight. And you did this so that people will not steal your pens? I said, isn't that kind of like being sick of people taking dollar bills out of your wallet so you're going to fill it with hundreds so you'll show them? Or they better not take these. So, okay, I mean, you know, there's a certain point where you realize that logic back and forth is not going to pay off. He wanted to buy the pens, he bought the pens, and that was it. He bought the silver one, the white one, the green one, the blue one. So here's where it gets funny. I take Lori out. It had to be just after Thanksgiving. I take her down to the city, and we go. I guess we went to Umberto's. I love their spicy clams. Went to Umberto's, and then we went over to Ferrara's for dessert. Then we're walking up the street, and you know all those little Asian shops with all the stuff in them. They got, you know, the flying birds and the bandanas and hats with whatever. And it's where usually they have the other stuff, the bootleg purses or whatever. And I see this guy has Mont Blanc pens. I said, excuse me, how much are those? $10. $10. I said, what if I buy more than one? How many you want to buy? I said, a lot. He said, $5. I said, I'll take 10. He said, all right, pick them out. You know where I'm going, right? So I get the 10 Mont Blanc pens, and in the same colors that he got. And I'm telling you, you couldn't tell the difference. I wish I had a fake here. The only way you can tell the difference in a fake Mont Blanc pen is on a real Mont Blanc pen, the little, I don't know if you're going to be able to see this or if it's going to focus in, but the little mountain on the top is some kind of composite, and it's actually embedded into the top of the pen. But a fake is just sprayed on with like paint. You can scratch it off. So there you go. So I go home, I get a crossword puzzle, I wrap the 10 Mont Blanc pens up in the crossword puzzle, I wrap the crossword puzzle book up in paper, and I send it to John as his Christmas present. We didn't really do presents for Christmas, but this was an exception. We did presents for Christmas all year long. So I talked to him on Christmas. Didn't talk to him on Christmas. I talked to him on Boxing Day because, you know, he does the family thing. And let me tell you what, he is into it. Decorations, the whole nine. So I called him up and I said, did you have a Merry Christmas? And he said, yeah. I said, did you like your present? He went, very funny, Steve. I said, what do you mean, man? What do you mean very funny? Well, obviously mine didn't come in the box, you know, that there's the plush box with the velvet stuff in the thing that pulls out and the little booklet with the number on it. You know, I mean, it's serious, and I'll bring my box tomorrow for the one for mine, and I'll show you what it looks like. But these just show up, you know, in a thing. And so he goes, very funny, Steve. I said, well, what's with you? Didn't like it? He goes, well, the problem is Lisa dropped them out all on the table, and now I can't tell them apart. I have to open them up and look at the cartridge. I said, well, what does that tell you about buying pens on the plane? He must have bought $2,500 worth of pens. Mine cost $50. There you go. And I'll bet he wound up using them, too. So that's the Mont Blanc story. And, that's the Mont Blanc story. God.
That's the Mont Blanc story.
Yes, it is.
Laugh it up there. Yeah, he... He liked sharing that stuff, you know, showing it to you.
Yeah, showing it to you.
Like giving it to you, but no. He liked showing it. Who wants that? I mean, you know, although, come on, he gave me those four Civil War guns. There was that.
He bought you and I both very nice watches for a birthday.
I know that, but I'm talking about the, like, he collected Capodimonte porcelain, Disney porcelain, if you know what that is. If you know what that is, you're cooler than me. It doesn't take much these days. But he really loved it. He didn't just buy a bunch of expensive stuff. It was John's version of
Beanie Babies.
Graceland or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah, collecting Beanie Babies.
I mean, he had you saw the things if you saw me play the Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous, the Marilyn Monroe anatomically correct dolls. And he had Scarlett O'Hara in the
He named one of his dogs Scarlet. He named his dogs after movie stars.
Yeah, after movie
Errol
stars.
Errol Flynn, he had Flynn.
Right.
He had Marlena for Marlena Dietrich.
Right.
He had Scarlett for Scarlett O'Hara.
Mm-hmm.
Fitz was not.
No, Fitz was Fitz
perfectly.
Perfectly.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, he was, and he named the puppies all different. You know, who has like 10 Rottweiler puppies and then keeps them all? You know who. Anyway, yeah, he was nuts. And you know, it's...
He was nuts in a good way.
Yeah, in a great way.
Mm-hmm.
Because not so nuts that he wasn't... If you were the same kind of nuts that he was, and I don't mean rich nuts, I mean salted nuts. He embraced it. He enjoyed that. And he loved the story thing. He used to... Because I used to tell stories on the bus, right? And we had years of them, right? And he would say, I'll tell a story about...
Always stories about him. And he would sit there listening like a little kid, smiling, like listening to stories about him.
Yeah. Tell him a story about...
Oh, okay. Well, we got to get on to our next story.
Oh, do we? I thought, but not before we do this.
Okay.
Oh, yes. Very exciting.
Yep.
Okay, anyway. Yeah, this is a funny story. This is The Breeze. I mean, you know, I've been blessed. I don't think I ever had a roadie that I wasn't friends with or I didn't truly care about, and that I, you know, that I'm not still, maybe not day-to-day friends with, but, you know, I still talk to them all on one, you know. You know, like your children after they go off to college and say, yeah, I love them all. I do. And without them, they were as integral to my performance as anybody could be. They made more changes back there and they did it invisibly. Well, Breeze wasn't always so invisible, but... In fact, I saw him on last night on the Mark Farner video. He was teching for me at that concert, yeah. So.
Huh.
Yeah,
okay,
so
Breeze was Steve's roadie.
Yeah, Breeze was my roadie.
Okay, so set up the story. Or do you do that in the
I don't know, I think
throwback.
I do it. I think I tell the story. So,
okay,
you know,
so then.
This is just, it's just, you know, the Breeze was, he was an excitable young man.
Yeah, he was young when he first started with you. And he was a drummer. And he thought Steve was the shit.
Anyway, it's a great story, and I love the Breeze, and I'll tell you a funny thing about him. When we first said to him, hey, you know, you want to work for the band? Oh, yeah, yeah. And I used to pretty much give out all the nicknames just because I wouldn't know who somebody was, and I would assign a name to them based on some characteristic or their job or something like that.
Right, like we said, TV John because he worked.
Yeah,
for
TV
a cable
John because
company.
he was a
lot.
Yeah,
like a lot of Johns around.
Yeah, there was too many Johns. There was Dr. Fibes, who was a different
John yep.
and so on and so forth. There was
your brother John. And
John. Those nicknames we don't share.
John and Tony.
Right, right. Yep. Yeah, right.
So.
Anyway, so we get, so that was actually the best way of, you know, knowing who we were talking about when we were talking about him. Mm-hmm. And so Breeze is working for us. And I don't know, I was Magic Steve, so I was Magic Steve. It was the Madge, the Magical Madge. I mean, I had all those, you know. And so I said to Breeze, I said, we're going to have to come up with a nickname for you. And he said, I already got one. Really?
Well, his name was Richard Breon.
Yeah, his name was Richard Breon, and he said, yeah, I'm the Breeze. Later come to find out he made it up on the spot, but it stuck.
Yes, it did. Everybody knows him as the Breeze now.
Yeah, from Robin Zander, the guys in Brian Johnson, they all know the Breeze. They wouldn't know Richard Breon. But,
no.
And he's... It's hard to forget. Love the Breeze. I love my brother the Breeze. I really do. So,
okay, so let's...
So here you go. And, you know, there's a little visuals in the beginning. Enjoy it.
Kick it!
I've got a great story for you. Let me get some... No, that's not... That's the wrong picture. I wonder if it'll... let me just see.
Let's see what we... Oh, there he is. The Bundini. The Brizzini. The Drummer Breeze. My number one drumming brother from another mother. There he is in all his glory. The Breeze. Oh, and what's that? A Ford LTD. Well, that looks like Dad's car to me, Breeze. Now you have to, Breeze is a, sometimes he gets a bit nervous, you know, and especially if Dad is letting him borrow his car. And understandable, because Dad was, he was tough. Dad was hot, burning a little over boiling, but, you know. And a Breeze was truly impacted by the sternness of his Italian father. Basically scared the shit out of him. And, you know, this is the 70s. Breeze is a young man, just coming into the business, a new fan of the band. I'm trying to get him in so that he can work as a roadie, you know. I always like working with people that I like and that I get along with. So, I'm schooling him, dropping little bits of knowledge on him here and there. And somewhere along the way, I can't remember what we were doing, but he loved Pink Floyd. We were driving somewhere. I think we were in my Corvette. And he turns on the radio and says, "Gonna look for some music?" And I say, "Yeah, sure, go ahead." And he's going through the stations and he comes on Another Brick in the Wall or some Pink Floyd. And I said to him, it's not really driving music for me. So I said to him, "Well, we can't listen to Pink Floyd." I said, "Bad things happen when you listen to Pink Floyd in the car. And I'm telling you, you know, so, you know, change it. Because I'm not into any catastrophes or any of that." And he goes, "Okay, Madge." And Madge, because I was Magic Steve back then. I still am. I just don't wear it on the little thing around my neck. So, I love the Breeze. So, I think we were on our way to a gig, and Breeze was, he had just started working for me. He had to go through his trial by fire with the management, and, you know, everybody had to ask him questions because now we were a huge rock sensation, so we had to do things like that. And so Breeze gets the gig, and I said, "Well, look, you know what? I'll ride with you. You can come pick me up, and I'll ride the gig with you and whatever." And he said, "Well, okay," because he get his father's car. So he comes over, and he's showing me that his father just had this brand new stereo put in the car. Awesome stereo, worth more than the car. And I'm thinking to myself, "Breeze, you know what?" So I go right into my tweak mode, and I'm tweaking the treble and the bass, and I'm looking at the EQ, and I'm going through all the modes and all this stuff, and Breeze reaches over. Breeze reaches over and hits a button, and I guess maybe it was a tape. Pink Floyd starts playing, presses a button, and we're hearing Pink Floyd. And I said, you gotta turn that off. And he goes, and I'm reaching to grab it, and he's reaching to grab it, and he goes, "No, Madge, no, don't turn it off." And he takes his foot off the brake, and bang, right into the car in front of us. This is in front of my house. Nice one there, Breeze. And I scream out at the top of my lungs, "Floyd!" And he's sweating, and he's scared. Let me see if I can get that picture back for you. Here, come on. He's scared, and he's freaking out, and there he is, and he's sweating, and he's shaking, and you would have thought I had a banana to his head. So now, I can't take this car, and okay. So the episode ends, we go, he does some gigs, and so on and so forth. And you know, he gets chewed out by his father. Now he has no car, so he's riding with me to work or whatever it is, you know, to the gig. And because he's still training, so I got to be there when he does the first, you know, blah, blah. So, time goes on. Breeze becomes a schooled roadie. I mean, he's there. And he always really was very inventive and very clever at solving problems. You know, if you had something break when you were playing live, because he was a drummer, he understood what it was that it was going to take to get me back to a place where I could play. And you know, for me, my relationship with my roadies was always, you know, that symbiotic thing. It doesn't happen back and forth with, you know, I can't do what I do in that big kit and relax without knowing that there's somebody there to pick me up if I, you know, fall off the wire. Okay, so years go by and we have, there you go, this is about that time. And we've got a horse farm now. We rented a horse farm in Mayapack. Oh, there he is in all his glory. Rented a horse farm in Mayapack, and some of the guys in the band lived there, and it had this amazing, it was in Baldwin Place, I'm sorry, but up near Mayapack off of Route 6. It was a 77-acre horse farm. There's the car. We're not done with the car yet. There's a 77-acre horse farm, and an old, this was the place where I told you it was the old barn where Mark hit his head on the door jam and had to get his head shaved with do you remember that story? With the silver wings on his head. Same place. Only it has a cabin on it. And it's really cool. I mean, it's really, really cool because we can rehearse in this cabin. What's going on here? Oh, I see. Okay. So we can rehearse in this cabin and we can set up all our gear. And we do that. The cabin is separate from the house. Like I said, a couple of guys in the band lived in the house, and Larry and I didn't live. Larry lived in White Plains. I had my apartment in White Plains, and that was the way it was supposed to be. But we had this cabin, and we could put all our stage gear in there. It had a little fireplace. It was really cool. And I had a picture, but you know what a cabin looks like, and this was it. Single story, nothing in there. We took everything out, just the drums and the amps and whatever chairs we needed. And so Breeze is up there one night, got his dad's car, got dad's LTD, and he pulls into the horse, and it's up the Taconic Parkway. I was going to show you a picture of it, but it's pretty much in the woods. I mean, if you have a 77-acre horse farm in Upper Westchester, Putnam County, you're upstate. Not a lot of that going on in White Plains or Bronxville or whatever. And so, a lot of things went on at that. We had the golf cart with the bullhorns on the front of it and the other story. But Breeze is up there on this one particular night, and I don't remember why we were taking the piss out of him, but we were taking the piss out of him. And he was getting frustrated. You know, it's just one of those things. And we were writing. I really don't remember what we were doing, but we were writing material, and I don't know, for some reason it was pick on Breeze night. And so he says, well, I'm not going to stand around and take this off. I'll see you guys later. And he storms out of the cabin, and we laugh and don't think another thing of it. Until about 15 minutes later, we hear a knock on the door. Guys? And it's the Breeze. Transition for you. It's the Breeze. This is important. Okay, so it's the Breeze, and I said, what's up, man? And he said, can you come with me for a minute, man? And I said, where you want to go? He said, just can you come with me, please? And he's nervous. He's got that Breeze look, that look. And so I said, okay, man, you know, we had taken the crap out of him. There's Dad's LTD! So we walked down the driveway. It was kind of a gravelly driveway out to Baldwin Place Road, which was where that was the county road that went by the house. And I'm telling you, this is in the sticks. And so what had happened to poor Breeze is he was backing up out of the driveway, out of our driveway. Long, blah, blah, blah. There's no lights, country road. And what he did was he backed out onto Baldwin Place Road and then so far back that he went into the drainage ditch across from the house. Now, what this means is, that his back tires, the frame of the car is resting on the concrete, and his back tires are spinning in midair, making no contact with anything. He's not going anywhere in Dad's LTD. So I'm thinking to myself, okay, what are we going to do? And so I look, and there's no way for me to move the car, and I said, you have a jack? And don't forget, this is 70s. With this jack, you know, chicka, 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 right, that jack. And he's in a ditch. The frame of the car is resting on the road. The wheels are hanging in space in this ditch. And he has to walk around, step over the ditch. He opens up the trunk and pulls out the jack. Now, on this particular car, you could hook the jack onto the chrome bumper. And so I said, all right, listen, don't worry about it. And he goes, well, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? And I said, I'm going to get you out of here, man. And he said, really? And I said, yeah, just do what I say. So I said, get in the car. And he goes, I want to see what you're doing. So I said, all right. And I jack up the car, right, all the way to the top of the jack. I mean, it's all the way to the top of the jack. And he's freaking. And the car's suspended in space like this. And he goes, well, what are you going to do now? And I said, well, now you're going to get in the car. And when I give you the signal, you're going to hit the gas. And he goes, okay. So I'm standing back there behind the car. And I have one foot on the bumper and the other one on the ground. And I said to him, Floyd! And I kicked the car and the jack tipped over and it went out onto the road and saved Breeze's ass big time. Floyd. And we talk about oh, God. I tell you what, the stuff that went up at that farm, oh, there were kids that used to hide in the woods when we'd be rehearsing up there. They'd have parties in the woods. They stole a golf cart.
Bert, you know I'm talking about you.
From the driving range, they put some bullhorns on the front of it, and they used to drive it all over our property because there were horse trails all over this, you know, where we were living. And I guess they used to roll a couple of and hang out in the woods and listen to us rehearse. They had it made. I mean, you know, it's like an amusement park with a live band. And I'm sure I'll be hearing from those guys because now that we can trust each other, the stories will, I'm sure, get deeper and more. So don't forget, you know, if you have a do, you remember. And
I think that was him.
It was.
These days it's more like, do you have a can you remember?
Yeah.
That was fun.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
And you know, just to give you the, you know, how I do that, you know, for me it's all about being somewhat spontaneous. I mean, I like, you know, we don't run by a script. We have, you know, we know what we're going to play when we know, and sometimes we don't know, and It's more supposed to be a party at our house, you know, than it's supposed to be, you know, late night with Jimmy Fallon.
Yeah, we fly by the seat of our pants.
Yeah, we just, you know, and that's something that I love. I love improv. I love it's, you know, if you weren't here tonight, although you can go back and watch it, but if you weren't here tonight, you didn't see what happened tonight. That's the way I always felt about Rat Race. And because it was always evolving and changing.
And Whistle Band 2.
Yep, and Whistle Band 2. You know, it just, because that's what, you know, when you're in, or when I'm in the right situation musically, that's what always happens. It grows, and everyone grows with it. Now, you know, and it's fun. And I'll tell you what, just a reflection for a moment, because I watch the stories. I pick the stories, but I don't, what the heck is that? But I don't watch them, you know, I don't watch them before I play them, or I'd be here all day. So I just pick the ones that, you know, I know how they go, and I find the top and I find the tail, and then I cut it, and there it is. But I'm looking at that picture of Breeze, the one where I'm holding the banana to his head. And that was one of the nicest hotels, the funky, nice hotel. That was the one with all the feeders.
Yeah, like somebody's grandmother.
Yeah, it was like hanging out at somebody's grandmother's house. It was just a charming little place in, you know, Northern California-ish. And
thank you, Mousy.
There's Mouse in the house. And, yeah. You know, we all stayed there, and I, you know, I'd be so happy to see my friends in the morning.
There were little balconies with hummingbird feeders in California.
Yeah, so you got the nature.
And there was a little brook running past it.
We would get up to go to the gig, and or whatever it was, and or everybody would come down for breakfast, and it was just, hey, man.
Right, they served homemade breakfast, very country.
Which, you know.
Yeah, which was like, you know. Different. It was like vacation.
It was great. So anyway, lucky to be there, lucky to have that, and lucky to have friends like my roadies, and especially Breeze, and you know, you guys know who you are. Rasta, Josh, my God.
Musk.
Who?
Musk.
Oh, Musk. Can't forget Musk.
Can't forget Musk.
Musk was there for the great stripper dance on the
That's a furniture. Story for another time.
It's absolutely a story for another time. Anyway.
Okay, so tomorrow night, we have Free For All Friday.
Do we wait? Do we have something that, you know, that cheer? We have no cheering for that?
Yes, we do.
Yeah!
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, see what happens when there's two sets of buttons. Anyway, kids. Join us tomorrow night for some real improvisation.
That's right.
See our friends. I love Friday nights. Miss Mouse, we'll be looking for you. Even if you're gigging, we need you to check in.
Yeah.
Let us know how it's going. Because Stevie's got a gig, kind of. Anyway.
Not tomorrow night.
No, not tomorrow night.
You got Indian food tonight.
Oh.
That's ready.
Oh, so if I don't see you in the future, I will see you in the pasture.
Good night, everybody.
Nighty night.